Hello, everyone, and welcome to this workshop on silvopasture, getting started with silvopasture.
Good grammar and spelling are important, but if you want to write essays that inspire,
we will also be covering writing essays that inspire. We are happy to be hosting Dr. Ashley Conway. She is an assistant research professor at University of Missouri Center for Agroforestry, focused on silvopasture research. Originally from a small farm in Washington State, she obtained her bachelor's and master's in animal science from Washington State University and served 2 years in the Peace Corps in Zambia promoting agroforestry. She received her PhD from University of Nebraska-Lincoln in animal science ruminant nutrition, where she studied integrated crop livestock systems in the Midwest, including utilizing baled corn residue and grazing cover crops. So thank you for being here with us. And Ashley, I'll hand it over to you.
Wonderful, thanks, Amy. If I had known I was gonna be talking about writing essays, I would have added a couple extra slides, but we'll have to wing it, I guess. So let me just share my screen here for a minute. All right, so I am so excited to be part of this conference, everyone, and I'm happy that you're here with me. I am gonna be giving you really a crash course in silvopasture for today. And I hope that at the end of the day, you have more questions than when you came in with, because that's really the nature of the beast with silvopasture right now. We're gonna go over some of the basics, what is silvopasture and what isn't silvopasture, because that's a very important distinction. And we're going to get into some considerations that you can take into account when you're thinking about silvopasture for your own farm. So really just starting at the very, very basic beginning, when we talk about silvopasture, we're talking about a specific agroforestry practice. Now this definitions will change depending on where you are in the world, but here in the United States, according to the USDA, we've categorized 5 common agroforestry practices. These include windbreaks, forest farming, riparian forest buffers, alley cropping, and silvopasture. Now, this order that I have here of least complex to most complex is really sort of my designation. So it's not necessarily an official categorization, but really when you think about what's involved with the system, how many dimensions it has, when windbreaks, we're really talking about a one-tier system, and forest farming sort of just one-tier aspect. When we talk about silvopasture, we're getting into really complex interactions because we're integrating 3 or more components into a functional system. And each of those components requires its own management. That just exponentially increases the complexity. So the technical definition then of silvopasture is the intentional integrated management of trees, forage, and some type of livestock. It seems like a very straightforward equation, but again, when we think about the complexity that comes from each type of component, so we have so many different categories of each of these that we can really combine into a functional silvopasture system, it ends up looking like a lot of different things for a lot of different people. I like to call it a la carte agriculture because you can really select what works best for you, and it still will be called silvopasture if you manage it well and intentionally. But with that comes so many different challenges because it really is sort of almost bespoke. You know, what works for one operation isn't necessarily going to be the best option for somebody else, like even your neighbor down the road. It's the beauty and the curse, I say, of silvopasture. It's what makes it so beneficial and so flexible and functional in so many different situations. But it's also what makes it really hard to nail down for recommendations and research because it is so variable depending on where you are and what you end up selecting. So let's just quickly run through all of the broad strokes of options that constitute a silvopasture. So for the tree component, you can plant and incorporate trees for timber. Hardwood crops or pine even is a very common silvopasture. Specialty crops like nuts and fruits, habitat trees. So when we're talking about woodland silvopasture, cultivating these trees for wildlife habitat, or windbreaks along the sides of your pastures. And then fodder trees. So there are subsoil pasture systems where the trees not only offer shade, but an additional nutrient resource for the livestock grazing. For forages, it can be run the gambit. You can focus on native species. You can focus on introduced species, legumes, brassicas. Some like grazed alley cropping is a type of silvopasture where you have an annual crop like corn or sorghum that you then go through and graze. I feel like that's a silvopasture management practice. And the livestock can really be any critter, cattle, sheep and goats, pigs, poultry, even pollinators, I think would be a technical silvopasture system. If you grow trees in a forage for like honeybees and then you raise bees as your livestock, technically, according to these definitions, that's a silvopasture. It's pretty exciting. So what we're talking about when we think about putting all these components together is really creating a multifunctional system. What do I mean when I say a multifunctional system? So if we were in person, I would tell you this story. I mean, I can tell you now, but it has more impact in person. So my now husband wanted a Instapot so badly. And I said, why would we get an Instapot when we have a crock pot, we have a rice cooker, we have pots and pans? And he's like, well, it does all of these things in one. And I'm like, it seems so redundant to put all of them together when we have perfectly good single service dishes that do these same things, right? Why would we buy another kitchen gadget, for lack of a better term, to do all of these things? Well, he was right. We got an Instapot and it's pretty much the best thing ever in my unofficial opinion. and I told him that he was right and I was wrong. Having one tool that does all of these different things, it might not slow cook quite as well as our specific slow cooker, but having them all in the same place doing the same thing or doing all of these different things in the same space is really beneficial, because we've been able to downsize a lot of our kitchen and it does many more things on top of just these single use kitchen utensils. So it's kind of a silly analogy, but to me, I think it's the best way to describe what we're talking about when we're talking about a multifunctional system. You might sacrifice some individual aspects of a function, such as when we're talking about monocrops. If you grow corn in a monocrop system, you're going to have more yield than you might have in an integrated system, but there's an over-yielding component when we're talking about integrated systems. The individual components might be less, but when you add all of it together and you combine all of the additional benefits that you see from soil health, from pollinator habitat, from animal production, from timber production, for a silvopasture system, it's a much better land efficiency value. You're doing a lot more on one piece of land. So it requires stepping away from some of our preconceived ideas of what a really productive piece of farmland looks like or a really productive piece of woodland looks like. Specifically, like what benefits are we talking about? Like what functions will a multifunctional system give us? So this is just a brief overview. All of these components have been individually studied in a lot of different settings and have been looked at. And some of the environmental benefits include improved soil characteristics, nutrient retention, improved water quality, improved biodiversity of the system. You can see increased livestock performance in a silvopasture system. Sometimes, I need to clarify that that isn't always seen, but sometimes you'll see increased livestock performance, at the very least equivalent, but we'll get to that in a second. Definitely, often you see an improvement in forage quality in a silvopasture system. Improved tree growth is commonly found in particularly timber production. Animal health and well-being, reducing heat stress from the introduction of shade. And you see some economic benefits too. So that's not to say that silvopasture is always profitable. I think we gotta, again, shift our thinking from what we traditionally think of as very productive and successful economic income, like enterprise for a farm. What you see is increased revenue diversity. You have different income streams rather than just having one crop or one stream of revenue from selling your calves. You have multiple options that you can count on for revenue over a period of time. And ultimately this, again, like I said, this increases your land efficiency. Some more specific studies that have looked at this. Again, this is by no means comprehensive, but I do want to go over some very specific instances that we see. This is a study that was done by Rob Kallenbach here at the University of Missouri before I got here. And he compared the performance of heifers in a pine, loblolly pine silvopasture and a walnut, black walnut silvopasture, compared that to an open pasture. And they found that in the silvopastures, there was reduced forage biomass, but it didn't end up affecting heifer performance. There was equivalent performance. Likely, this is due to the improvement in forage quality and digestibility due to the shade. And we can go into that more if you're curious later. But ultimately, again, this overyielding concept where you might see reduction in biomass, but because it's greater in quality, you see equivalent performance. You're not really losing anything, and you're making better use of your land. It's more efficient in that sense. In 2005, Bergler and others found that integrating trees into the pasture positively altered the botanical composition. So again, another instance of improving biodiversity. Biodiversity is a very nebulous index. It can look like a lot of different things. So I wanna be cautious in overinterpreting that. But depending on how you're looking at it, incorporating more species and more types of mammals and invertebrates and that sort of thing can only benefit, in my opinion, the system as a whole. In 1999, this is a little bit older, but the pine silvopasture research is pretty conclusive in the sense that if you manage carefully with grazing, adding animals to your system will actually improve the growth of the timber and the quality of the timber that is produced in that system, because you're managing the forage underneath the trees that would otherwise compete with the trees for growth. And so then that ends up being a very financially competitive system when you compared it with just growing trees by themselves. In 2008, Hale and others found a 20 to 39% increase in soil organic carbon when compared to an open pasture for a silvopasture. Now this to me makes sense because trees are much more substantial chunks of carbon than just grasses. And so anytime you introduce trees into the system, obviously you're going to sequester more carbon. And we can talk about this more if you guys are curious. I think that carbon markets and carbon credits right now are really, really picking up in the stream of dialogue about regenerative agriculture and about addressing the impacts of climate change with livestock and with grazing. And it's pretty complex, and I have some thoughts and opinions on it. Ultimately, we shouldn't overinterpret this, but it is worth noting that, I mean, planting a tree is never a bad thing. You're gonna see increased soil organic carbon and more sequestering of that labile carbon component. So in some spaces, this is like $1 million plan. Like, this is a great go-to. In other spaces, it's probably not gonna have as much of an impact, but it is something to consider in this conversation around regenerative agriculture and grazing. Specifically looking at woodland silvopasture. So, and we'll get into this in a minute or two here. There's a couple different types of silvopasture, but taking a wood space and thinning it and grazing animals in woodland silvopasture, this particular study found that the forage production was greater in the silvopasture compared to just unmanaged woodlands, which makes sense. The forage quality was greater in the silvopasture compared to the open field. So these two things together mean that the silvopasture was really the sweet spot of production and quality. And what they found was you're gonna see, it doesn't matter how you do it, you're gonna see similar average daily gain for the cow-calf across all of these systems. For the silvopasture. So we really have some more research to do here. And I'll go into this next study, which also looks at woodland silvopasture specifically. So this was looking at some of the real costs of establishment. In this particular study, this is as close as I really have to the most current estimates for what it would cost to establish a woodland silvopasture. This was done in the Northeast in New York, so it's not exactly local, but again, it's a good starting point. We see quite a bit of revenue from the sale of timber, some establishment costs for thinning, what the cost of seeding and fence infrastructure looks like, and about what we would expect for forage production as estimated as revenue based on biomass. This is another table from this study that I really wanted to draw your attention to, because this does compare like the process of thinning a woodland compared to just leaving it, and what that looks like for more traditional plantation style silvopasture or using silvopasture as a tool for woodland management. And what I want to draw your attention to here, I have the in the red box, the silvopasture option, and in these two green boxes, the option of no management, which is just leaving your woodlands alone and not doing anything at all with them. And across the board, silvopasture is the most, provides the most net present value per hectare, especially when you compare it to just leaving it alone. So in this case, more investment and more management is actually going to benefit you economically in the long run, is what I'm taking from this. Again, if you have questions, we can talk more about this as we go on. We have plenty of time to discuss. For right now, I'm going to kind of orient you, and I've mentioned this already, but I want to orient you around what types of silvopasture might look like for you. So when we're talking about silvopasture, there's really these two types. And it really is based on two different starting points. So are you starting from already wooded area, you've got grown trees there, you don't have to wait 20 years for them to grow and establish, it's already a woodland, an existing woodland space, and you want to turn it into a silvopasture. How do you go about doing that? Or do you have this open field here that's been grazed and you want to add trees to the system to improve it? So how you go about managing your silvopasture is really going to depend on these two starting points and what that looks like. There's some considerations though for this, particularly for the woodland silvopasture. We have a history, and this is seen in our research, our current research, and where we are in the state of recommendations that can be made for this type of research. I would say in my experience, since I arrived at the Center for Agroforestry, the woodland silvopasture is probably the type of silvopasture that most people are interested in, that they see the most opportunity in. They're less interested in planting trees and they want more to utilize the wooded spaces on their property that they already have. But this is also the most difficult because we have an institutional history of really promoting livestock exclusion from our forests and from our woodlands. Now, this is not without reason. We have a strong body of evidence that dates back to 1945 and even earlier. So we're talking like shortly after Dust Bowl times, we see a lot of aggressive grazing practices, putting cattle into woods and just letting them run loose and graze as best they can and in sort of almost a range type situation was really destructive. And there's really good evidence that shows that. Like this is documented, it's good research. However, it is old. And it's kind of been used as a gold standard for why we shouldn't put livestock into woodlands, particularly cattle, particularly large, heavy livestock. And I think that we're reaching a point now where we're kind of looking back at why this is the way it is, where this recommendation has come from, and that maybe in some cases, exclusion of animals, exclusion of large livestock and small livestock alike might be actually not quite the direction we should be going in. And how can we reintegrate our spaces with animals and trees into really productive systems? Because when it's not done well, you see virtually no forage production. The ground is just destroyed. You don't see any improvement in animal performance because they're eating, there's like nothing to eat. It's just mud or dirt or destruction. And you really see long-term ecosystem damage. So if there's one thing that I want everybody to take away here, is that silvopasture is not the same thing as woodland grazing. So woodland grazing, we're talking about unmanaged, unmitigated animals in the woods doing what they do. And it's almost a living barn situation. That's not what we're talking about when we talk about silvopasture. And the key is really management. woodland grazing can be very destructive. This was a meadow at one point, and it's been damaged pretty heavily by cattle. Who knows, this is what this was. It's a mud lot now with trees in it. And ultimately, if this ends up continuing to stay a sacrifice place, these trees will probably die over time because of compaction and disturbance. It's really not benefiting the animals at all, and it's not really benefiting the trees. So these are some older statistics, but the most recent statistics that we have here in the Midwest. In the of forested farmland, the estimate is that about 34% of forested farmland is grazed in to some extent. Forest land, however, only 6.6% is grazed. So, you know, my question is, okay, what's the difference between forest land and forested farmland? And I should have, this is not moving forward now. No, I took that slide out. So I would say forested farmland to me is sort of the edges of your property. And I'm assuming that this resonates with a lot of people. If it doesn't, that's okay. But here in Missouri and in a lot of other places I've seen here in sort of the central Midwest, before you get to the plains, there's a lot of secessional forests, what we're calling them. It's regrowth from agriculture abandonment after a colonial legacy of clear cutting land, grazing, cropping, and then leaving. We have these kind of second round forests that have all come up. Think of it like you buzz your hair and it grows back as kind of thick and stubbly. So what's returning isn't necessarily what has historically been on this land. And the system isn't necessarily being managed in a way that it has evolved or is ecologically healthy. Now, this is, again, a complex discussion that involves foresters, of which I am not. I'm learning a lot about forestry, but I do want to put in the caveat that I'm not a forester. But there are lots of places here in the Midwest that have pastures, that have open fields, and you have edges or some back 40 that's just wooded, that's not really doing anything, that's really just kind of taking up space, and people want to know, what can I do with this? I feel like it should be managed, but I'm not managing it in any functional way or any way that's really like benefiting me economically, or even is it benefiting itself ecologically? So there's a lot of questions. And as we have this conversation of silvopasture, I want everybody to be aware on your property, this may not be the case for everybody. This is a screenshot from a county. This is from Lawrence, Kansas, Douglas County in Lawrence, Kansas. And I'm sure you can find similar biological surveys in your own area. You really need to be aware of the historical ecology of your property and of the places where you're living. I think it goes without saying, but I feel like it needs to be said, you need to be aware about the history of your land, who was on this land before you. If you're a colonial descendant, you know, be aware of who manage this land before. If you're a native descendant, what did your people do before? And understanding that we need to think about ways to manage the land that really are harken back to the ecological history of that space. Are there spaces on your property that really want to be something else, but they aren't allowed to do that right now based on the physical bio constraints of the system as it is? So can we introduce silvopasture as a tool to help drive that system forward into a way that really is more ecologically appropriate? And I don't know if you all can see this, but we have in the red here, these are areas that were historically forested and the places that are currently forested. And you can see there's quite a bit of difference. There's some overlap here. There's a lot of places that have trees now where there weren't before. And then a lot of places, especially up here, that just aren't forested anymore and they used to be. There's another component of this in that historical land surveys really don't make a distinction for savanna, which a lot of these woodland ecosystems are or were at one point and really want to be because they were managed with fire. It was either forest or it was grassland or prairie. And this sort of halfway point in between these two is this savanna type ecosystem isn't really well distinguished or well defined in these surveys. So it's something to think about, you know, It's not really an either or. There really is a middle ground that we can be working towards. Excuse me. So this is a place down in Rolla, Missouri that I visited, and the landowner is wanting to shift towards this sort of woodland type of silvopasture and take this unmanaged thicket, for lack of a better term, and thin it out. There's a ton of invasive species in here, lots of autumn olive, lots of multiflora rose, kind of clear out some of this underbrush and then underplant some forage to be able to have a nice park style savanna ecosystem, and turn it into a woodland silvopasture. If this looks and resonates with you as potential on your property, then you're in the right place, because we're going to talk about some ways to there's some things to consider, at least if you're interested in this. One thing that I will point out, and we'll get to this in a second here, what this landowner has done is he's selected very similar age trees. And as you do this, a consideration is that we really have to have a recruitment plan, because forests themselves are living and trees will grow, they will age, they will die. You need rebirth and regeneration of younger trees to sort of replace these other trees as they grow and age out. So this is the question, where do we begin? There's a lot of information. And I wanna know, you know, based on my situation, where do I even start? How do I even start? Am I doing silvopasture already? What can I do to improve it? Or I really want to know where to begin. And hopefully these next few steps will help. So we have some transition stages, and I think we'll kind of hit, some of them are the same no matter what starting point you're working from. Some of them are a little bit different. So we'll kind of go through all of these together and I'll clarify which type of silvopasture it would be better suited for. First off and foremost, across all the boards, you're gonna wanna do a property assessment. So if you have land or you're working on land and that you're wanting to establish silvopasture on, you need to do several walkthroughs and really learn your property and learn your space. I think this is where understanding the history of your land comes into play, knowing what it does and what it wants to do and what it can't quite manage right now is important, because you'll get a sense of what silvopasture and what types of management practices can benefit your property. Once you have an idea of what you have to work with and where your starting point is, then you can start planning. And the proper planning, I think, is key, because it's easier to plan and then change your mind rather than get several years down the road and realize, gosh, we really don't have a good fencing system in place for grazing the way that we thought we did. Or, you know, we actually end up, we don't have quite enough capacity to be carrying cattle. We should probably be raising sheep or goats or something a little bit smaller. So understanding where you're starting and then planning is probably going to be the best advice I can give you today. And then moving on to the practicalities, execution, what you're going to do for thinning, what you're going to do for planting, what you're going to do for grazing and animal management. So I do have a question slide that I think maybe I have it in the wrong spot, but I wanted to pose a question, and I think Heather dropped it in the chat. I want this to be as interactive as possible. I know that given our format, it's a little bit challenging, but I do want to pose a question. Of these two types of silvopasture that we're going to talk about, I'm curious to know which type interests you the most. Are you more interested or curious about this woodland silvopasture, or are you really curious about learning more about this plantation style silvopasture? And I believe, let's see, can't quite access my chat right now. Hang on, here we go. Heather has dropped it in the chat. Oh no, that's a different one. Is there a difference between silvopasture and integrated livestock crop besides the tree component? So for that particular question, I'm assuming like integrated livestock crop systems, is more of a generalized term. So silvopasture is a type of integrated livestock system or crop livestock system. Anytime you put animals and crops in the same space, and whether that space is divided by physical barriers or time. So you can have a, like for instance, a cornfield and then grazing corn residue for part of the year would also be an integrated crop livestock system. It's more of a general term, and silvopasture is a very specific type of integrated system. It's probably in my mind one of the most integrated types of system because all of these components are existing in the same time and space on a piece of land. And I do know that we have a bit of a delay. So before we get to these questions, but again, I just want to pose the question to you all, what type of silvopasture are you more interested in? Are you more interested in the woodland silvopasture or the plantation style silvopasture? So as we wait for upvotes to come in, again, it can look like a lot of different things, and there's benefits to both types, and you can probably have both types on your property if you have a wild hare and you're interested in that. More often than not, plantation style silvopastures end up being affiliated with more like timber or specialty crops like pecans or walnuts or orchards. And in the woodland silvopasture, you see not necessarily food or product type trees, but it's more of ecologic, like habitat based silvopasture. And you can still, as some of you know, if you're located here in like more in the central Midwest region, there's a lot of really valuable hardwood species like oak and those have value, but they just take forever to grow. So if you're growing those for specifically for timber, that's a multi-generational investment. So there's other benefits that you'll see as those trees are growing as far as ecological services that silvopasture can get for you or offer, I guess I should say. We have one vote for woodland so far. I'm not surprised. I think I would say probably 10 to 1, it has been my experience so far of interest in woodland to plantation. And here's the tricky part. Of these two types of silvopasture, guess which type has the most research and the most data? it's going to be the plantation style because that's much easier to control and to measure. And woodland silvopasture ends up being a little bit trickier because it is sort of a natural system. I think that there's also the component of really not wanting to do that because for forests and woodlands, like I've indicated before, the history is we just don't want to integrate livestock into our woodlands because it can be too messy and it's best just to keep them out altogether and find alternative ways to manage your land. But I think, and one of the things I haven't mentioned yet is particularly like in the West, we're seeing a lot more interest in utilizing livestock like goats specifically to manage forested lands, especially public lands for fire management and fire control. And that's a valid use of woodland silvopasture in a sense. You know, those animals don't have to spend their whole life in the forest. You know, it can be a singular or seasonal event. And in my mind, that's a type of silvopasture system. You're using livestock as a land management tool. Lots of value and lots of opportunity in that. Okay, so I'm seeing one vote for woodland, one vote for both, awesome. One vote for plantation with food trees and cows. Another vote for plantation. Oh, interesting, all right. So leaning more towards plantation. That's very interesting and exciting. Keep those votes coming in because I am curious to know overall what folks are more interested in. I will talk about both, so have no fear. We'll get to both. All right. So, knowing that, are there any other questions at this point for anything I've talked about? Because now we're going to start getting into some of the nitty-gritty considerations for your property, depending on what type of silvopasture you're interested in. So I'm going to wait for a minute or two and see if any questions come up. All right, so again, I encourage you all to pop in with your questions at any time. If anything strikes you as confusing or you're not aren't quite sure, we can address them as we continue on. So moving forward to some considerations for your property, if I can get this to move forward. So first thing you're gonna do is a property assessment. Learn your land is essentially what this comes down to. Identify how many acres you're talking about. Are you talking about 2? Are you talking about 20? Take careful assessment of what the slopes of your land are, because that will impact how you graze it and how you manage that. What your soil types and characteristics are for your property. There's NRCS offers a web soil survey website. If you're familiar with it, you can check out web soil survey and find out specifically on your property what soil types and characteristics you have. You can also assess your ecotype. So if it's more of a, there's so many ecotype classifications, I can't even think about it. What types of soil you have will affect the types of trees that you will plant and how well they do and how you need to manage them. So you're going to want to do a tree species survey. A forester can help you with this part. They'll help you assess the understory and do a pasture and forage survey. NRCS is a great resource for this because they have both foresters and grazing specialists that can help you do pasture walks. The more people you have out, it's a process, right? So I encourage you to go out several times with several different people and walk your property, have people point things out to you that you wouldn't normally be noticing. And they'll kind of elucidate some of these questions. What trees are you working with? Do you have invasive perennial bushes on your place that need to be taken care of? What types of pasture, forages do you have already? And do you have water sources on your property? Are there riparian areas that you need to be aware of? So this will help inform not only spaces that you shouldn't be grazing your animals because they're sensitive, and also how you're providing water for them when you set up a silvopasture. I am seeing a box appear on my screen, so I'm going to stop share for just a second and try to remedy that.
And Ashley, there are a few questions coming in as you're speaking. One you just covered was asking about NRCS.
Okay, yeah. So this would be a great time. I'll take a little bit of a break here.
Asking about what kind of cost sharing for silvopasture practices. Do you feel like you covered that?
Yeah, so I'll get into cost sharing towards the end.
Okay.
And what sort of opportunities there are. Cattle and bison evolved in forested ecosystems. So you feel like it is poor woodland management that leads to them being destructive there. So bison specifically here in North America, I think it's important to remember that cattle are an introduced species in North America. And I think that the key here is historical management practices. So when bison evolved and lived in these forested ecosystems and these savannas, there was also fires, low grade, frequent fires that were constantly happening to create these open savanna type ecosystems. And they had a huge range. So the way that we raise livestock now, we're talking about keeping higher stocking densities and higher stocking rates on smaller spaces for longer periods of time. And that can be more destructive. This is sort of gets into like the concept of mob grazing, which I have some concerns about how that's really defined, but it does kind of get into the concept of before you would have one very large, short, intense grazing event with a huge stocking density. You have large family groups and herds of these bison or cattle moving through a space, and then they're gone. And that property, that piece of land doesn't see large herbivore disturbance again for at least a year, if not more. Now, in the way that we raise our ruminants now, you're gonna have to manage your land very carefully to keep that ratio the same, or at least imitate that, in the sense that now the tendency is to continuously graze or even rotationally graze spaces and increase the number of grazing disturbances in a shorter period of time. That can be destructive, yes. I have grazing consult. Yeah, so we'll talk about NRCS here towards the end. Are there recommendations for establishing the pasture part in a woodland? I know most seed and seeding recommendations are for open pasture. Are the resources adapted for silvopasture? The short answer to that is not yet. Most of the recommendations that for like shade grown species will fit very well into a silvopasture, but it's not been studied really well. And so that's something that I'm trying to work on, that other people are trying to work on, and to develop forage species specifically for grazing in silvopasture systems. Depending on the type of tree, you can have some competing effects. And so it's not necessarily a direct comparison. Just because it's shade adapted doesn't mean it's going to be really suitable for a silvopasture. Question 5, when using livestock to disturb soil and woodlands with the goal of creating silvopasture, what is the best way to know it is time to move them? 5 to 12 days, Joel Salad, people like Joel Salad suggest 5 to 12 days. But when is this, what is a sweet spot? Also M-I-Z-Z-O-U. So I wish I had a number. And this is, I think, the question. We really, for recommendations, people want specific numbers and they want like hard and fast rules that really are like bottom line. And if I'm being honest, we really don't have those yet. And I think that's important to know. I'm not going to tell you a number because it might not be appropriate for your space. What I will say, again, this is where consulting with a lot of livestock grazing specialists and foresters is going to be important, because they might give you 3 different numbers and then you can compile all those together and use those as sort of touchstones for what might work best for your operation. I think days and like numbers end up being very deceptive, because then you stick with that number even when the signals from your property are telling you otherwise. You might have more time, you might have less time. So it's a moving target, unfortunately. I wish I had a better answer for you, but I think that's important to know that it is, there is a bit of an art to it, just like any type of grazing. Like grazing management is more of an art as much as it is a science, in the sense that you really have to learn your property and learn your land and learn your livestock to know at what point do you need to pull them off? At what point is it too much and you're grazing to the detriment of your system, or your cattle too? I mean, that's a thing. So yeah, it depends on the type of forage as well. So it's not a cop-out answer, I promise you. It's that we just don't have good numbers for that. I would say always err on the side of caution. If you feel like maybe you're unsure and that you should probably pull them off. Like I think that's going to be your best bet every time rather than pushing it maybe a little bit farther. Okay, so I'm going to move on. Now we're going to get into some specifics here. So let me share my screen again. Hopefully the box doesn't show back up. This is Polly Sheep. She has suggestions for establishing silvopasture. Take lots of pictures, take lots of measurements, utilize public data if available, make a binder. I love binders. You're going to want to have as much information that you can compile about your property as possible when you're coming up with a starting place. This assessment's really critical because especially like down here, I've highlighted riparian areas. If you have spaces on your property that really shouldn't have livestock on them at all, for instance, like a meadow or a glade ecosystem that are sensitive and should be protected from regular grazing. It's important to know that so that you can exclude those spaces and really be judicious in that sense with your property. Once you have the assessment done, planning comes next. So fencing, we're in the process right now of planning the development of a long-term silvopasture site on one of our research stations. And fencing is such an important consideration that especially if you don't have a lot of experience with managing livestock, which is possible for some of you, considering how you move cattle, how you house your animals when it's in the off season, do you have alternative spaces? Do you have shelter for them? How are you gonna get the water to them? How are you gonna work them when they need to be worked? These are all considerations for the animal, like the logistical management of your property that you gotta think about on the forefront rather than further into the planning process. Especially if you're planting trees, how you design your paddocks could be really important. So tree protection is something that I often hear, particularly with plantation style. How am I going to protect my seedlings as they grow? For me, the easiest way to do that in my mind is to fence them out in an alley. So as you're planning your property and planning your silvopasture, does your planting format and your fencing format, is that conducive to protecting your trees in that sense? How are you going to get water to your animals? Do they have a water source? Are you going to have to truck water in by hand? That's not really feasible in the long term. So you got to make sure you have a plan for all of that. And then access, not just for the livestock component for the management, but also access to manage your trees. Do you have a way to go in? And if you need to remove a couple of trees and thin or get a down fell log out of there, if you're harvesting your specialty crops, you have a way to get those harvesting tools in there when the time comes. Is it very slopey, or do you have some slope challenges that you have to work with? Are there water crossings involved? And again, this protected areas plan, if you have places that really shouldn't be grazed or have heavy foot traffic or vehicle traffic, do you have a way to protect those spaces and make sure that you're not doing damage to them?
Ashley, someone asks if where they could find people in their area that would help with assessing properties.
So again, NRCS, I feel like, is probably a great place to start. Your local department, conservation departments have resources available. Soil and water conservation districts. NRCS, I highly recommend because they do have specialists for all of these categories. And depending on where you are, NRCS has a silvopasture program. And again, I'll talk about this a little bit later. Extension, reach out to your local university extension because there's definitely grazing specialists and forest specialists in the university extension network. And then definitely, so the Savannah Institute is another great like nonprofit agroforestry group that does a lot of training and outreach. I would also say there's a lot of informal information out there. So I can't always recommend every bit of it 100%, but there are informal peer learning networks that are out there too, that you can talk to people to share their expertise and their experience.
I had in Wisconsin, the DNR sent a forester out to my place, and I had to specifically ask for someone who was willing to consider silvopasture. Not
interesting.
All yeah. of them, but did get someone. There was also a follow-up question talking about when to pull cattle out. What would be some of the signals that might cue you to pull animals out?
Yeah, so I would say ground cover, if you see visible bare spots on your ground. Forage height is another good indicator. So depending on the type of forage you have planted, if it's less than 50% of its grown height, like grazed down, that's a really good indicator for open systems as well. So I think those are probably the best numbers that I can give you at this point. All right.
Thanks.
So which one's next? This is where I have the, which types of silvopasture generates the most interest for you. We've been sitting for a while, so I'm gonna take a quick break if everybody's okay with that. And I know that we've already kind of answered this question, but I wanna take the opportunity for you guys to write down thoughts that you have on these two different types of systems. Why each of them appeals to you, and why one over the other? Like what's the appeal? What's the interest? Particularly, I've noticed so far we see about a 50-50 split. So yeah, if you all are okay with that, take a quick break. All right, I am seeing some questions. So let's see, where do you find a list of people in your area? I don't think that a list exists, unfortunately. So again, on this previous talk, I think that the just keep talking to people is gonna be the best bet, and conservation departments are gonna be a great option. So this is the big question. If I'm going to establish woodland silvopasture, how do I thin it? What is the recommended thinning practice. So we don't, again, we don't have good recommendations at this point. So there's considerations for you as you come up with your plan. What you end up doing is going to be different for your property, no matter what you do. This is where your local forester can help. You want to consider the types of species that you're going to select and keep. What those growth patterns for those trees look like. Do you have slow growing hardwoods? Do you have very fast growing trees? What type of recruitment plan are you going to have? So again, this idea of the fact that your forests are really living. And so you have to take into account that certain trees will age out. You need to have younger trees that are protected and able to replace those trees as they age out. Is there value? Is there timber value in some of those trees? When you thin, you're going to want to target about a 40 to 60% canopy cover. And once you have that established, then you can establish your removal rate. Are you going to market your thin timber? Or do you going to want to keep them, keep it for yourself? Is there really a market for some of your timber? For instance, a lot of producers that I talk to, if they want to thin out their woodlands, they have a lot of Eastern red cedar. There's not really a market for that. So do you have a plan for what to do with that biomass or that timber when you're done with it? This is a forestry management recommendation. You want to plan for at least one third of your cleared biomass to stay on your property. This is a carbon issue. So if you remove that much of the material, there's you're sort of interrupting that nutrient cycle. So think about ways to keep at least a third of that biomass on the ground and in your space. You can chip it and mulch it. You can use it for road building if you have a remote access issues. And then you can kind of plan out some of the spacing and identify specific trees to keep. How you do that, prune and trim to reach an appropriate canopy cover. Is that going to happen mechanically? Are you going to have help of large, heavy equipment? Are you going to use livestock to help improve and move that thinning process forward by running, say, for instance, goats through and clearing out some of the shrubby underbrush ahead of time?
There's a comment that thinning trees may leave the remaining trees vulnerable to strong winds, and that we've seen this in Wisconsin. Do you have a recommendation about, like, do you leave extra trees pre-planning for wind to take some out?
Well, so this is where I think a forester might have some more insight onto how susceptible those trees might be to wind. The key for silvopasture is you want enough light to reach the bottom of the floor to encourage forage growth and to create a forage base below. So leaving too many trees will sort of counteract that goal of creating a forage base for your trees. However, if they are susceptible to felling based once they thin out, that's something that a forester can help you strategize around. I'm not sure if it's a root structure issue or an age situation for the trees. And it might just be that adding or thinning a woodland in that space isn't necessarily the best strategy, and that you should consider maybe a plantation style silvopasture where the trees can more actively be protected to be grazed. If you do keep more of a density, like a stocking density of trees, you risk overshading the silvopasture and not providing enough forage underneath for grazing. When that happens, then you start seeing detrimental impacts of grazing, because the forage itself helps protect. You create a strong, solid root network. If you don't have enough forage, not only to sustain your livestock, but then you start seeing risks of erosion and compaction.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So the conservation effects, you really want to target your ecosystem goal in this sense. Do you have a woodland that really is unmanaged, that needs some work? Or do you have a particularly strong, healthy system that you're just wanting to maybe take advantage of and incorporate livestock to help shift it a little bit one way or the other? So you can help identify your ecosystem goal by assessing the species abundance, the composition diversity, And if you have to, consider planting some additional seedlings or species for a really desirable tree species. White oak is what comes to mind specifically in our area. This is really important, particularly here in the Midwest. Have an invasive species action plan, because again, once you open up that canopy and let light into the system and clear out the understory, you're gonna potentially release a lot of invasive species that will take full advantage of this new wonderful solar experience. And you're gonna wanna be on top of those and have a plan for how to manage those so that your forage base in the more desirable forb species can be encouraged. Invasive species require intensive management regardless. So it's more of just having a strategy, knowing that it's probably going to come, and then having a strategy of how to do that. Are you going to manually manage them through cutting them down? Are you going to use herbicides? Are you going to use fire? How is that going to look for you? Always want to try to avoid any excess soil disturbance and compaction if possible. And then consider, again, soil or forests are living, short-term and long-term management plans are necessary. This was a tidbit that I found. I'm not sure how supported it is in silvopasture research, but the suggestion is that you're gonna need to do lighter and more regular thinnings over time for long-term management than compared to traditional forestry. So like you were saying about asking a conservation forester out, to have somebody who specifically knows about silvopasture and understands the goals of silvopasture compared to traditional forestry. I don't know how ubiquitous those foresters are, but if you are getting recommendations from somebody who isn't as well versed in silvopasture, understand that their recommendations might be heavier and less frequent, and so to adjust it as necessary.
There's a question back to the keeping a third of the biomass on the land. Mm. If burning would be an appropriate way to do that?
Oh, that's a great question, actually. You know, I'm not sure. I suspect there's probably some good studies that compare leaving green biomass in the ground compared to burning for the carbon component, but I'm not too familiar with it, so I'm not going to speculate beyond the keeping in mind. I think the point of that one third recommendation is to ensure that you're not shocking the system, and understanding that a lot of the invisible species that are supported by the biomass of the trees and the perennial shrubs might be affected deeply if you remove too much at once.
Thanks.
So another question break, and I won't pause as much because we do have a delay, and I'm hearing that we shouldn't take too many breaks. So I'll pose this question, and I want you guys to think about it as we go on, and maybe we can address the questions either as they come up. Don't feel free to ask them, and consider it and drop it in the chat box. But I want to know, what are your biggest questions or concerns about establishing woodland silvopasture on your property? Even if it's not something necessarily that you're thinking about or that you're really interested in, if something really sticks out at you as like, what's the deal with this? I kind of want to know, because that will help inform me as well as I do more of these presentations and focus my research. Again, this picture is from that same place down in Rolla, and you can clearly see a demarcation of the line of where he has been thinning and managing this space compared to what it was before. So it is a process. It's a time intensive and a labor intensive process, and it's not something that happens very easily overnight. So regardless of whether you do plantation or woodland silvopasture, you're going to need to consider some overseeding of forages. The considerations for this: are you going to do a single species? Are you going to try to encourage a mix? Are you really interested in only using native grasses that are historically well suited to your area, or do you really want to have some more reliable guaranteed production with some introduced species, like orchard grass is very common in silvopasture systems. Once you decide on a species, you're going to have to understand what sort of seeding rates you're going to need, which is, again, is going to vary depending on the species that you select. And then considering how to plant and overseed, what's the best time of year based on that species? Are you going to need to rent some equipment to do it, or do you have access to a seeder? Are you going to need to incorporate amendments of any type? So whether that's an inorganic or an organic fertilizer with your system, will you need some irrigation needs to get it started, or can you really rely on that latent seed bed to take over? As you're selecting the type of forage, consider the animals that you're raising. What sort of forages can influence their nutrition? Tall fescue is very common here in Missouri, and depending on where you are, this may appeal or like be appropriate or not, but fescue has some problems, it has some challenges, and it is one of the things that makes silvopasture appealing to some producers down here, because there are tendencies for fescue grazed cattle to be more susceptible to heat stress because of the toxicity component. So as you select a forage, are there those considerations? Do you want fescue? I don't know. Some people might, or they just know that they're working with fescue and that's a consideration to have. So always keep in mind what you're grazing and how you're grazing it. So this is, since I'm getting a lot of mixed, about 50-50 of plantation style, this is where we start getting into the fun stuff, tree planting. What types of trees do you want to plant? Are you wanting to plant timber trees? Are you wanting to plant specialty crop trees? Are you really just interested in some more like natural oak regeneration, your woodland silvopasture? What sort of species you select is really sort of up to you and your own production goals, which is pretty exciting because the sky's the limit, in my opinion, and what your property can sustain. Once you have your species in mind and what type of trees you're planting, you want to identify the best spacing and pattern for those trees. This is going to differ based on what you select. So consult with, if you're thinking about specialty crops, consult with those production organizations because they'll have management recommendations like for pecans or hazelnuts or chestnuts. If you're thinking about your woodland silvopasture and doing like shortleaf pine or white oak regeneration, foresters will have some great information and conservation departments will have great information on what types of planting strategies you're going to need. This is the key. So the investment budget is critical. Not only this tends to be the biggest barrier, I think, for folks, because there is an upfront cost associated with buying and planting trees. And there is a timeline for return, specifically whether we're talking about timber, where you know, at earliest, you might see returns within 30 years, 25, 30 years before you can harvest this pine, or specialty crops that take anywhere from 5 to 10 to 12 years before they start fruiting. And being really productive. So that upfront cost is, I think, a real barrier and concern for people. Not only that, are you going to need some specialized equipment to harvest your specialty crops? Are you going to need labor to help manage these trees and harvest this material after you plant and they start performing? So this is where...
Can you give a few examples of what you mean by specialty crop?
Yeah, so specialty crops would be like nuts or fruits, hazelnuts, chestnuts, pecans, walnuts, apples, pears, cherries, etc. So this is where, and I think I have another slide later on that we can hit on, but NRCS specifically will offer equip cost sharing funding for silvopasture. And I have a schedule later that shows like what they'll pay, but it's important to note that the silvopasture that's only supported by NRCS right now is plantation style silvopasture. So they will not offer equip funding or technical support for woodland thinning. So if you approach NRCS for equip funds, note that they'll cover costs of trees and planting of the trees, like this initial investment, they'll help subsidize that for you to overcome this initial cost, but it's only going to be for this particular type of silvopasture. This is the other consideration that I think, based on the response, this might really be of interest to people. when you're talking about specialty crops, fruits and nuts, there's some food safety regulations that you have to work around when you're considering integrating livestock. So because food can't be marketed the way that the regulations are, if they've had ground contact where there's potentially fresh manure within 90 days. So you're gonna have to have a plan for how you're gonna harvest those specialty crops to mitigate that regulation and mitigate that concern. So the poo is great because it just is enriching to the soil and there's lots of microbes and great stuff. But from a food safety aspect, you do have to consider a strategy for how you're going to either exclude those livestock at least 90 days before harvest, or really show that specialty crop isn't coming in contact with the ground where there's potentially fresh manure. Again, and this is in chemical treatment. So if you have this is geared towards more organic production, and I recognize that, but even within organic production, there's some treatments that your specialty crops might need that may not be conducive to grazing or livestock. And so that's something to always think about, that when you're sharing this space, a lot of our tools and instruments are really designed for single production type systems. And as soon as we're integrating these again, we really have to be thinking about the overlap and potential risks.
Someone also asked about strategies for protecting new plantings.
Yeah, so there's a couple. Tree collars are pretty good, but they are expensive. So there's several different types and brands, and I couldn't tell you exactly what specific brand at this point, but you can find tree tubes that will essentially protect your trees from stripping or grazing or being destroyed by protecting it in a hollow tube. It's almost like a PVC pipe, but they're a little bit more flexible. And then as they grow out of it over the top, then you can remove it and do a more larger protection ring. Some people get very creative with like T-posts and wire. For me, I feel like those are all effective, but depending on how large of a space you have, they may not always be cost-effective or really practical. So in my mind, what I feel like is the best strategy is if you plant in a row, you have a row of trees that need protection. So then you string up some wire on both sides and create essentially an alley that is excluded. And you can graze livestock on either side or like around it, but you've fenced out an alley essentially where they don't have access to those trees. Depending on what species you have, that looks different. Cows and sheep are a little more amenable to just some simple discouragement. If you have goats, you might need to think about something a little bit more robust. I always say that if it doesn't hold water, it won't hold a goat. And goats get very excited about trying out all kinds of new browse. So that's something that advice will change depending on what type of species you're talking about for animals.
There's another question about where to find varieties of trees that wouldn't shade too harshly and would stand up to animal exposure.
Well, I don't know if there's like specific species that or varieties that are more robust against animal exposure as far as like tree species. So your best bet for finding those are going to be species that perform best in more close plantings, I would say, is probably the best analogy for a silvopasture system. And you're depending on, particularly if you're talking about specialty crops, the organization that's affiliated with your particular specialty crop is likely going to have a lot of really good planting resources for that specific tree species and what that looks like for each different type.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think Savannah Institute has some worksheets on that on their website.
Yeah, so at this point, we don't really have the like any improved varieties that withstand livestock any more or less robustly than other species. So I would say pick the tree best suited for the production goals of what the tree is giving. So if that's shade, then you want a robust, fast-growing, canopy-driven tree. If that's a crop, then you go for the crop. And do your best to be proactive about protecting it with fencing.
This is stepping back, but asking over what time span is the 20 to 39% carbon increase in the hail study?
Oh gosh, the hail study. That's also a good question. So I believe that that study was over a 3-year period. But I'll be honest, I can't even remember what trees were in that particular study. So it's a number, it's not the number, you know, there's definitely wiggle room. It might take 10 to 20 years before you see really significant accumulation of soil carbon. It starts with your starting point. So if you have a particularly deplete piece of ground or soil that you're working with, you're going to see incredible gains over a very short period of time. If you already have really healthy carbon-rich soils, then the net gain is really not going to look like a lot. That doesn't mean it's not beneficial though in its own way.
And then there was just a comment that burning biomass might damage the mycelial net and cause problems with the remaining trees.
Yeah, so burning is a tricky topic. So, and again, I'm not a fire expert or a forest expert, but I do know, and this is, we were talking about this in a previous webinar, these lands have historically been evolved to be managed with fire. And that's not to say you're going to go out and burn like every month or every year even, but that disturbance effect will in the long term have positive impacts. And I think we need to shift our thinking about fire as a very destructive source and actually start looking at it as really a life-giving force in the long term. So how we use that tool is very critical, because you are right. It immediately can be destructive if done not properly. Always consult with somebody who has experience with fire, particularly in your specific ecosystem, because the plants that are there, the grasses that are there, the type of fuel that is there will change how the fire burns. And that might not end up having the result that you are anticipating that it should have. But ultimately, I really advocate more use of fire for land management, because prior to colonization, that was the thing, right? There were low intensity, very frequent fires that happened every 5 to 10 to 20 years. And that helped manage the land and evolve a lot of the species that we see that aren't thriving today because we aren't using fire. But that's a great point. It definitely is a consideration why you should be talking with people who know more about fire than me.
And then there's one last question and we'll be caught up on questions. And it looks like we're getting close to our time here.
Yeah.
Do you know of any ties between new farmers putting in a silvopasture working with 4-H youth clubs that have animals?
I don't know of any specifically, but I highly encourage this relationship. I grew up with 4-H myself, and I think those relationships are fabulous. So if this is something that appeals to you, I don't know of anybody that's doing it, but it's definitely possible, and I highly encourage it.
Awesome.
Okay, great. We're making great time. So once you have your trees planted, your forest in, your trees planted, you're growing your silvopasture, you planted your forage, now you got to plan the grazing management. So really the animals are the last component to add in. And again, we've had some conversations about numbers, like what does that look like? What does grazing management look like? What your stocking rate and what your goal is based on the forage production is going to be a moving target. And it's going to change every year depending on the weather conditions, on the growth. If you start seeing pests that come in that you really hadn't anticipated, how you graze is going to change and constantly be moving. So you have to at least have a plan of how you're going to be flexible in that regard. Identify your animal production goals. Are you maintaining dry cows? Are you trying to finish out cattle on grass? Are you really just raising poultry for eggs? This will all influence how you're grazing and how the intensity of the animals on your land is going to look. again, plan your fencing and labor needs to meet your grazing plan needs. I feel like nothing is more frustrating than setting up a fence and realizing that you can't actually move your animals because the gate's not in the right spot. So planning ahead and trying to cover as many bases ahead of time as possible is key. Consider where you're gonna provide water for your animals. If you're gonna need to provide minerals and any nutritional supplements, how that's gonna work. I always recommend rotational grazing as a good grazing strategy, regardless of the system. I think rotational grazing is superior, if I'm being honest, to continuous unmanaged grazing for the health of your pastures. And it's a lot easier to control in the sense that, yes, there is an additional labor component, but you're able to manage the health of your pastures a lot more easily when you're out there rotating your animals. We asked about a number, a ripcord number for what's the absolute bare minimum of coverage or forage biomass that you need on your property before you have to pull the ripcord and parachute out of there and get your animals to a different spot. This number is going to look different. And the best way that you can identify that is once you have your forage species and you know how it's growing, talk to your grazing consultant and they'll help you identify really the resiliency of your pastures and how well they can manage and sustain grazing for how many days. And then you need your animal management plan. What's your nutrition plan for forage production and feeding value? Are they gonna need supplementation? Do you have a non-grazing season plan? I think it's highly unlikely that you're going to be able to have a silvopasture that will be able to sustain year-round grazing. And I think in general, grazing systems, you should always have a non-grazing season plan because there will be times of the year where there's just not enough forage to provide nutritionally for your animals. Excuse me. So have a plan for stored forages like hay or stockpiling or crop residue, and just have a backup plan. This is almost more emergency planning than anything, but knowing what your land can sustain reasonably and then planning for situations like drought or fire or flood where you won't have access to those pastures anymore, but you still need to provide nutritionally for your animals. Have a health management plan. What's your vaccination schedule look like? How are you protecting against diseases and parasites? And then how are you going to incorporate that? This is all very standard, just livestock management that really doesn't differ simply because you're in a silvopasture. It's more of just general animal management that you're going to want to keep in mind if livestock are new for you. If not, you should already have a handle on this. And I guess just dial in anything that might change because of your silvopasture management for your trees. Are you going to have to do anything different because you're protecting your trees or you don't want to graze quite as heavily and what that looks like in this instance? So once you have all of these things planned, I always recommend building a management calendar. So something throughout the year to help you identify when you might turn your animals out, when you might breed, when you're going to expect babies, when you're going to be selling or marketing your critters. Again, this isn't something that's necessarily specific to silvopasture, but if livestock management is new for you, this is a very helpful tool that I absolutely recommend just to help manage the animals and then the system as a whole. And that's it, you know, it's as easy as that, right? LOL, it's complicated. And what I'll say is even you can always plan the heck out of things and have all your bases covered and you end up throwing that plan out the window because things come up and you end up realizing there's things that you haven't anticipated. And so it's always best to just be as flexible and try to prepare as much as possible. We're getting close to the end. So I guess now what are your biggest questions or concerns about animal management? I'll take more, all your questions at the end. We did talk a little bit about EQIP through NRCS, ask for help, talked a little bit about peer learning opportunities. It is a process. So consider that this isn't something that is going to be implemented overnight. It's going to take time. And yeah, so let's ask questions now.
I know it's a popular thing now to think about planting like chestnuts and hazelnuts for pigs. Do you run a silvopasture with pigs similar to with ruminants, or what would be different considerations with that?
So pigs get very aggressive in the sense that they'll go after the dropped nuts, and some of the like ruminants might, chickens might, but really pigs take full advantage of the dropped and down nuts. So I feel like management wise for pigs in a nut type system, you're going to rely more heavily on the tree crop as a nutritional source compared to a ruminant based system, where unless you're growing like a biomass tree for fodder, like this is more common in tropical areas, then you're not going to rely as heavily on the forage underneath for the pigs, because the trees themselves are also providing forage. So, and that is a little bit different, but again, that comes down to just pig management versus cattle management almost. And then what you can anticipate or calculate the trees providing for nutrition compared to just the forage, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. I know in my, I'm clearing out a wood for silvopasture. And I've been trying to think what's the best, I'm doing part of it with a skid steer to pull the material out. And I question whether it's, I would be better to wait until winter. I'm sure that driving over tree roots with a
equipment. So thinning and burning for that process, I would definitely recommend doing in the winter. Forest assessments are also easier to do in the off season. So that would definitely, time of year is a consideration too, for sure.
So when the ground is frozen, the compaction won't be as bad.
Yeah, for sure. Definitely.
The dream would be horses, but.
I had somebody ask me about a horse silvopasture, and I was unsure where to begin even with horses.
Well, I think we are pretty much at our time here.
Well, I encourage you, there's a lot of information, and there's, again, I hope there's more questions than when you started, because that means that you're thinking about how this could possibly work for you and apply for your situation. So I encourage you to reach out to me, to other resources. Again, NRCS is a great place, Conservation Department, Savannah Institute. We're trying to implement a silvopasture peer learning network, where we'll be able to get people who are doing this to in touch with people who are interested in doing it. Learning from each other is really the best process that farmers really want. So just keep being curious and asking questions, and I think everybody's going to try their best to advocate for this type of system, what it could look like for you, you know?
Yeah, it's an exciting time with the large scale experiment, and see what we'll all have in 50 years.
Yeah, I'm not discouraged by not knowing. For me, that's sort of my lifeblood, because that means there's just so much more to discover. So you don't always need a scientist to tell you either. Sometimes you can figure this stuff out just through your own experimentation.
Yeah, and it's kind of a it gives you permission to make mistakes.
We're all learning together. Exactly.
All right. Well, thank you everyone for attending our silvopasture workshop. And thank you, Ashley.
Thank you. I appreciate it.